A very good morning and welcome to this edition morning at NTV's Big Stories. The 22nd day of March 2016, exactly 1 month and 4 days after the last election, if my math is anything to go by. After the election, obviously we saw, and that doesn't require me to break down what has been happening in this country and the political scene after the election. But what's for sure is that the Electoral Commission did announce President Museveni as the winner of that election with a 60% poll result. The runner-up, Dr. Kizza Besigye of the Front for Democratic Change, was allotted 30%. The rest came in as follows. But then, of course, we had Amam Mbabazi coming in with 1.4% or thereabout. He is currently in court. The presentations have been tabled before the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court justices are conclaving, if I may use that term, to come up with a verdict. But as that be it, less than a week after the election results were released, we did see Dr. Kizza Besigye hold up at his house, not within his will, but certainly against his will by the security forces. Their reason, his ability to move around the country or wherever else he wanted to move, other than his home, would create a bit of skirmishes that they were not willing to entertain. Since then, of course, there have been a number of initiatives led by his party, the Forum for Democratic Change. One of those is the famous, or should I say infamous, call to boycott every Thursday. Boycott going to work in solidarity of your leader that is under incarceration. But also it went and took different forms, grew ears and legs, and also took the form of boycotting some musicians for their political affiliations. Then there is also the Tuesday edition of this initiative, a prayer Tuesday across the country at all Forum for Democratic Change offices. And then, of course, we did see the first one take place at FDC headquarters last week on Tuesday. And, of course, pictures from there showed very emotional people praying hard for divine intervention to the situation they are in. Long and short, after that, there have been calls from the government side. We are told no one has come out, substantiate them, or even acknowledge them. So the FDC, a way of extending an olive branch and saying we can have a dialogue, we can have a conversation. And last evening, we did run a story coming in from the Forum for Democratic Change press conference, perhaps to bring this conversation that I'm going to have with the Forum for Democratic Change president, Major General Mugisha Muntu. May call for this story just to put us into the right perspective. Let's go with story coming in from last evening, from yesterday, where the Honorable Reagan Okumu did say something about this court dialogue. From where, then we shall delve into the conversation on the big story with Major General Mugisha Muntu.
With an opposition unwilling to accept the outcome of the February polls, the dust is yet to settle after the incumbent President Yoweri Museveni continued his grip on power. He garnered 60% of the votes against his closest challenger, FDC's Kizza Besigye, in a race that attracted 8 candidates. Now, the opposition party's national vice chairperson in northern Uganda, Reagan Okumu, says the party has taken steps to engage the government.
We as a party, we continue to discuss soberly. Despite the criticism, people continue criticizing us. You see, you are using soft gloves. Fine, call it soft gloves, but we are going to be very, very systematic because we don't want to mess this country.
A month after the polls, the presence of security remains visible on the streets, while the police have placed Besigye under house arrest over his campaign of defiance.
If they think they can rely on police to deploy, how long are they going to sustain this police? How long? How long are they going to sustain this deployment of these people being given water every day? For how long? If we react? I can tell you, it will boomerang.
Okumu says a delegation of government officials have approached them for talks, an issue the Prime Minister shied away from weeks ago.
Quietly, he's sending up people. There have been some fillers, people from government. Unfortunately, they have been reaching some of our top leadership.
Government are always open for everyone, including our brothers and sisters on the opposition.
Have Have you met with Dr. Kizza Besigye or any other opposition leader, try and talk to them about peace?
I have not met with Dr. Kizza Besigye.
You intend to meet with him?
I have no problems with meeting anybody, including Dr. Kizza Besigye.
During the time we had the reform agenda, they sent fillers. I remember a lady delegation, we met President Yoweri Museveni in State House. And as a result of that, we started a national dialogue. And that national dialogue collapsed.
But even as the party warms up to the possibility of dialogue, it's also setting conditions.
If you think we are going to talk about the Kenyan scenario, we are going to talk about the Zimbabwean scenario, away from that. We are not talking about sharing any government. And the big question for us is, as FDC, we can only talk on a transition.
Speaking ahead of the polls in January at the end of his campaign in Chisoro in southwestern Uganda, the president rejected the notion of a unity government. In discussions he later held after the election with another presidential candidate, Major General Benon Biraro, Museveni maintained his stance, although he did welcome dialogue. Civil society and religious leaders currently charting a path for dialogue between the opposition and the government are yet to go public about their efforts. Shilon Huchere, NTV.
Very good morning, Major General Mugisha Muntu. You're the president of the Forum for Democratic Change.
Good morning.
I can see you're smartly clad in the code for black every Tuesday. How is that campaign going, by the way?
We have a day of prayers today, Tuesday.
It's been going on last Tuesday, of course. We did see those not very kind of pictures of you shedding a tear, very emotional and in deep prayer and meditation. Well, I know, of course, this Tuesday's prayer is even more symbolic, that it's Tuesday within the Holy Week. Yeah. And I can see that you're also using a multi-pronged approach to finding a solution to your challenges, and of course, divine intervention being one of those. But could you please just enlighten us on how the other efforts to try and ameliorate the country, or even very specifically FDC, from the kind of situation you find yourselves in, are progressing?
We are using different channels through which we would like to believe the Ugandan people would express their discontent. One of them also make a statement, like the one of stay home, because the main focus is to break the arrogance of the regime and also neutralize the sense of impunity with which the regime seems to think that they can do anything and go with it. So we'd like to focus the Ugandan people, all of us, to realize that we can't continue living in with the state of affairs that there are. Where you find that you more or less have a police state now. And it's a country that is, we are sitting on a time bomb, more or less. That time bomb doesn't have to go off. And that's why we are doing everything humanly possible to draw attention of all of us as Ugandan people to say we can defuse this situation. But the only way we can defuse this situation is to use different channels to make a statement to the powers that be. There's not going to be business as usual, but you can manipulate people for a while, even for a number of years, but there is always a limit. And change, we have to be very careful. There are changes which are smooth, but there are also changes which can be disruptive. We've gone through disruptive changes in the past. We don't want to go through any such disruptive change anymore. And we as the Ugandan people therefore need to make a statement to the regime that they need to stop where they have reached. They have crossed many lines before. But you cannot only stretch a situation too far. There is a time when you reach breaking point. And honestly, we really would like to see a smooth change.
When you talk about a smooth change, I just want to put it to you, Major General Mugisha Muntu. Yeah. Does this have more like a timeline, so to speak? Because we had an election, a winner was announced.
Yeah.
So what are we looking at? A change of regime before the 5 years that have been allotted to this one, or something that will come a lot earlier?
First of all, we would like to see corrective measures about the 18th February election. It's a stolen election as far as we are concerned. Mm. And in FDC, we've been drawing attention of the Ugandan people and also the international community on the need to have an independent audit. In fact, in the course, by early or mid next week, we are going to make a follow-up statement, because we made one statement. We've been slowly but systematically working on a number of things, and we're coming out with another statement in the course of next week.
Right over there.
Yep.
When you call for an independent audit,
yeah,
who are you saying should carry out this audit?
First, in the course of next week, as I've already indicated, we are going to come out with the nature of the audit that we'd want to see happen.
Oh, okay.
We also know that unless there is internal pressure as well as external pressure, we do not think that the regime is of a nature that can willingly get involved in that exercise. And therefore, a number of levers have got to be
pulled
for them to realize that, you know what, we need to ensure that we go in through this exercise.
I don't seem to get you right. Yeah. I asked who you propose or what your terms of reference for this independent audit are. Who would you propose or what entities do you propose could carry out this audit? Are you looking at who? Certainly not the Electoral Commission, because you hold it in terrible contempt. Are you looking at the United Nations? Isn't that stretching it?
No, the details are going to come in the follow-up statement that we're going to make.
You don't want to let the cat out of the bag just for me?
No, basically, there are technical aspects of it. Mm-hmm. Technical aspects. The most critical thing first, that it would be independent, that it would be credible, it would have terms of reference, it would have a checklist, would have to agree on that. All parties involved would have to agree on that. And would agree that we need to review
involved.
Parties involved, yes.
Are you expecting that the National Resistance Movement Party would be one of those parties involved? Are you reaching out to them?
I don't believe they can be involved willingly.
Mm-hmm.
But that's the whole point. You see, we as Ugandan people, everybody who believes that this election was stolen, we need to get the bottom of this so we can get a long-term solution. We must reach a point where even those who are in power, even when you are a president, when you've got control over the security services, to know that you must operate within the law, that you cannot operate above the law. That's the point we must make as a Ugandan people. So this is not something that is related just to this regime, but any regime that subsequently comes into power. So as a people, there must be a point beyond which we should not let those who are in power cross certain lines. It has happened in the past, but of course, change is also at times go through a very slow process. But from our reading
which
of the situation...
Which may not even be realized in our lifetime, are you saying?
No, absolutely not. I mean, you can see like what happened on 18th. I mean, before 18th, in the last 3 months.
So
you can see what was happening in the country. You can see all the tactics that the regime had been using in the past, using fear as a tool of manipulation, using money as a tool of manipulation. All those failed. And we as FDC would like to thank the Ugandan people because they took a stand.
Mm.
All those manipulations that used to work in the past didn't work this time around. But of course, on a technical level, much as they voted, they gathered their votes in largely a large part of the country. The votes were counted as they were at the polling stations, but the manipulation this time around, a lot of it happened between the polling stations and
the
National Tally Center. Of course, even in some parts of the country, there is quite a number of areas, as we'll be coming out with information, where in some place they weren't real elections. They just went on the tables and started ticking. And,
but you see, that's
you know,
so
it depends on which part
those
of the country
are statements
you're talking
that
about.
When you throw around at press conferences and all that, perhaps may not be taken with the verve and seriousness they deserve, unless, of course, you possibly put them through a jurisdiction like the Supreme Court, like your counterpart, Amaba Wasi, did.
We chose to take the path of an independent audit.
An independent audit, and not the court. But, of course, you've also been following very
closely.
Because
we need something to be done in a comprehensive way.
So you're looking at multi-pronged action. But then, of course, I'm sure you've been following the proceedings in the Supreme Court.
Yep.
And I'm sure you're waiting with glee and a high anticipation, like the rest of us, with the verdict of the Supreme Court justices. And without preempting or even trying to appear to even want to, you know, try to gag them or maybe, you know, put them in a difficult position as they write their judgment, wherever they are. Do you, as a party, whereas you chose not to participate and go to court, but did you welcome the move that the Honorable Mbabazi did in taking his grievances to courts of law?
The court process is legitimate, it's lawful, it's one channel through which one can express their grievances, and we have no problem in
anyone that
group that went through that path, but we've also been looking at what has been happening. We've got information that they broke into two offices of the lawyers, took
affidavits and other documents.
There's more than 100 of them, and other documents that were a basis for the petition that they were going to present in the court. We know the number of people who've been harassed, a number of people who are in hiding, who are supposed to be witnesses. So it's a path that is also quite complicated.
You see and a dark shadow.
You see a regime that was really bent on ensuring that it's not exposed.
But this is the same regime that is making underhand and covert maneuvers to reach you as the Forum for Democratic Change, perhaps even other political players, for a conversation, for a dialogue. We just saw the Honorable Reagan Okumu there talk about that approach that you've received. One, you may wish to validate that, saying that indeed some people from the regime have been contacting you as a party for a conversation.
There have been quite a number of emissaries from the regime who've been contacting the candidate, who've been contacting a number of our officials.
Including yourself?
I've not met any myself.
Oh, you haven't been contacted?
Well, being contacted and meeting them is a different issue. I've not met with any.
But you have been contacted?
We've been, as a party, certainly contacted. And we are very cautious because, you see, we are not strangers to this situation in this country. Cautious in the sense that, well, a number of people, they are new people, you know, like not only the regime that's been contacting us, we've been seeing a number of other actors in good faith who've been reaching out to us and saying, look, this situation
who
is
the other actors, for example?
There are a number of, church leaders, elders, and we understand the anxiety which most people have in the country, because we're a country with a lot of tension. There's a lot of anger simmering below what seems to be a calm surface, a lot of frustration. And there are people who are concerned. They think that this situation needs to be resolved. We understand those concerns, we share those concerns, but at the same time, we are people who are very cautious because we've learned through experience. First, we understand the psychology of the regime, of the leaders in the regime. We know how they operate. Some of us read them as, read actually the president is the main actor, like you read it in a textbook. So there are those who believe that a number of these actions that they are involved in maybe could help in diffusing this situation. However, from our experience, we are not people who just rush into anything. We first want to understand the intentions, the motives on the side of those who will be proposing like these overtures which are being extended to us. And therefore, we are not about to rush into anything. And in 2011, this situation, we went through more or less the same situation.
Absolutely, yeah.
Because again, there was tension, and the regime sent the same overtures. And that time we said, no, we cannot engage in any negotiations unless four conditions are observed.
One.
And one, we indicated that one, we could not go into those negotiations as FDC, that the negotiations must be broad, they must be beyond FDC.
Must
so
be
there must be participation of other
political actors,
stakeholders,
civil society.
Stakeholders. Two, that there must be a neutral arbiter or a facilitator. That we are not just going to go into a meeting where there's President Museveni, he chairs the meeting, and then you go into whatever conversation. So we aren't going to be involved in that kind of a negotiation. Three. That there must be an agenda. And part of the agenda that there would have to be a review at that time of the 2011
elections.
Of course, like in this particular case, there would also have to be a review on such an agenda. They also agreed that there needs to be a guarantor so that whatever you discuss and whatever the outcomes are, that you know that they are either organizations or a body that would ensure that they would cause all sides to the agreement to be held to account. Those are the four conditions.
I also remember the fifth one. I don't know whether it's... I also remember that you also said you're not going to go into a conversation where the person of Yoweri Museveni claims to be president of Uganda, that he must first understand that he is illegitimate and therefore does not deserve to be called president, and he comes in as a layman. Or if he's to be called president, then he comes as president of the NRM party.
That would have been part, I think, of the review process. That was in 2011. So basically what I'm trying to say is...
And they didn't honor that. They felt that the conditions were asking for far too much, right?
Well, there was actually no response, so we didn't know what they were to think about. It was neither...
And here they are again, five years later.
No verbal response, no written response. So while there are people who are anxious about dialogue, about discussions, some may be new to these situations. But those of us first who understand the psychology of the president and the regime and the other actors in it, who know that there are people who want to take advantage of any situation, they're not people who play fair at all, we understand. We are cautious.
If I get you right, you think that these overtures reaching out to you, one, either are not necessarily those of the regime, there must be some people who are trying to use a dire situation to benefit from it.
Or
it could be the regime, you know,
certainly the regime, because I know for sure from particular offices within the regime who have been sending emissaries. That's one. But two, they also other concerned Ugandans. We understand their concern, and we've always been open to dialogue. But at the same time, as I've indicated, we're also people who are experienced, who understand how the situation is, also know the people on the side of the regime, who any time they engage in anything, it's for manipulative purposes, not because that they are genuine, that they want to resolve a problem. So whoever is hearing about possible dialogue and needs to understand that, at least us in FDC, understand the conditions within which we are operating. We are very cautious people. We are people who never want to be manipulated. We are people who operate internally in an organized way. Because there are also times when they use those kinds of approaches as a way of destabilizing an organization.
And throwing away.
That has been tried on us for quite a number of times. We know how to respond to those kinds of maneuvers. We have neutralized quite a number of them. And we remain cohesive. We continue building internal cohesion and keep on focused on what we need to do, not only to strengthen ourselves as a party, also how to influence the situation as we move on in the country, because we are facing quite a complex situation.
So beyond the caution, are you still firmly in belief of those conditions, the four of them that you did mention that, you know, sufficed in 2011? Would those conditions still suffice now, or would you have even conditions?
It's the four conditions. Everybody who has approached us, whether he has approached Dr. Vezji as a candidate, whether he's approached us as a party, different party leaders, those are the same conditions we tell them.
Standard,
so fulfill those and we will
be on the table.
See how we can go into initial stages of working towards the dialogue, because you also have to go through quite a number of processes before you even reach a point where you can even go into dialogue itself.
But be that as it may, as a party president, at the moment, obviously, the party, I want to believe, is not only concentrating on Tuesday national prayers, Thursday defiance, and stay-at-home campaigns and all that. But one would be tempted to ask whether there is any other, especially structure-building initiative going on. Are you building the party base? Are you doing what, you know, like other businesses would do, growing your base and, you know, carrying out marketing campaigns to ensure that you have register all your supporters across the country? Are you doing, you know, building structures from the grassroots? Is that press going on, or you're still here at the top?
No, it's not a period for that. I mean, we've just been in an election. We've just finished the presidential parliamentary, and then we immediately after that we went into local government, three sets of elections. And then our main focus now is to put effort on all kinds of activities that we need to carry out, going through all measures, making contacts, trying to build broad coalitions across different interest groups to ensure that we focus on how we can change this situation. So that the stolen election of 18th, as it was announced by Chigundu, is not realized in real terms. That's our main focus, that's our immediate focus, and that's where we're going to spend all our time and effort.
Wow.
For now.
But
before we go into anything else.
And the question is, for how long? Until it's resolved? And if it's never resolved, we only see you do that and not much else in terms of building party structures to the end?
No, the immediate, of course, so there's the immediate period like we're involved in right now.
Yes.
And we will see how we move through April and see how we move through May. And we'll be making judgment every step of the way as we move. As long as we don't have our freedoms, as long as we don't have our rights, as long as the conditions in this country are not set right, there's no way we can tire.
Mejisho Mejisho Muntu, President of the Forum for Democratic Change Party, it's always a pleasure to have you have this conversation with us every time we have an opportunity to interview. Maybe just one final one before we let you go. It's just to put it to you that your party presidential flag bearer is under incarceration.
That's another, you know, another signal. You know, the nature of the arrogance of the regime, the nature of impunity, and that's why you focus on those. Because once you break those, then you don't see a situation where you go, you get a citizen, and not an ordinary citizen, a flag bearer of an opposition party, arrested outside the law. You don't charge them in the courts of law. You decide to arrest a person in the morning, put him in a police station, put him back in the evening. The courts of law themselves are being manipulated. That kind of situation shows you the nature of the regime that we have. And that's why we keep on calling upon the Ugandan people that we must break that arrogance.
And the question is,
so that it's not only our
Ugandan people watching you this morning are asking themselves, how?
What do you mean, how?
They're asking, you're telling them we must break this arrogance.
Absolutely.
And they could be asking
through different channels. And it doesn't have to be only us as FDC, because we are just a party. But there are many Ugandans who are not even members of any political party. But they are citizens who want to enjoy their rights and freedoms. So that's why we've been reaching out. There are civil society leaders we've been meeting with. We've been meeting with religious leaders. We've been meeting with political leaders. So different people can act in different ways within, as long as they are peaceful ways, and we can collaborate in a number of them. People can act separately in different ways. So as we keep on building this pressure, the most important thing is for the regime to understand that they cannot manipulate the people anymore. We have to make that statement. For example, the question of when we've been saying, let's make a statement. Let's all stay home so that the regime knows that there is a problem in the country.
But that stay home campaign also did seem to have been met with a lot of lukewarm reception from the masses.
I think there's still a bit of a misunderstanding on it, and we're going to keep at it. We can continue, you know, reaching out, sensitizing people about it. I believe at some point we will see it work, and we're not going to give up on that. Because there are different channels. There are people who have different inclinations. There are people who are not going to go on the streets and demonstrate, for example, but who can stay home safe, knowing that nobody is going to come and beat you up in your own home. So it's
you
a question
of
more and more engagement. And we'll keep on broadening the number of things that we are doing. We would like really to see Ugandans take all kinds of initiatives, simply to make a statement. This is our country. We must all be equal before the law. We must enjoy our freedoms and rights as they are enshrined within the Constitution. That's exactly what we are trying to build towards.
You're very right. Now, my producer tells me I have a little more time with you, which is very encouraging. I would just ask you from an operational point of view, as party president of the Forum for Democratic Change, we did see your presidential candidate move around the country and campaign for 3 months on end, and rather than he spend his money, we saw folks bring money to him, gifts and all sorts of other paraphernalia they thought would maybe help him in one way or another through the campaign, including and not limited to a chair, one wonders why, and a nice beautiful puppy dog. I hope he's giving him very good company in the house. How much are you doing in terms of fund mobilization run the activities of your party? Because I think some of the challenges that you as opposition party groups in this country face is the absence of resources, financial resources, to finance your activities.
Ever since the election, we haven't engaged in that, but we'll be doing so at some point.
Great. Now, very finally, of course, we now know that you are well constituted in the House. You have members of parliament that were elected on the FDC ticket. And you, without any doubt, are the majority in terms of from the opposition, if I may. And that, of course, puts you as the president of the party on a Herculean, presents you a Herculean task of selecting what we may one call a shadow cabinet. Have you addressed your mind to that? Or at the moment, you're still concentrating on these other issues that are an aftermath of the immediate
We've
election.
Been immersed in the after-elections efforts to ensure that we change the status quo. At least we ensure that the Chigundu announcement of a stone election are not realized. That's why we've been immersing our energies. However, sooner than later, we also have to pay some attention to the question of how the parliament itself will be managed on the side of the opposition.
General Mudishamont, it's a pleasure having you here on this program, and thank you so much for joining us and for enlightening us on a number of issues, including not limited to the Tuesday national prayers and, of course, the Defiance Stay Home campaign every Thursday, including not limited to the conversation that has, you know, been rearing its head in the court of public opinion, that indeed there are some overtures being made towards you as a party or as individuals to have a conversation with the National Resistance Movement Party.
Thank you. Pleasure's mine.
For the viewers, it's always a pleasure having you stay tuned to the program. And of course, it's very important that indeed you stay tuned to the rest of our programming here on our morning edition, Morning at NTV, for more quality programming is coming up. Just to preempt you, don't turn your dial. You may need to get some bit of comical relief with the next segment of this programming when we come to Everyday Life, which is going to be featuring perhaps arguably the most celebrated female comedian in Uganda. That's a part that you don't want to miss. Good morning. See you tomorrow.